Riverside Pain Physicians.
If you have a pain problem, it's a common concern. Some people are afraid they could be addicted to the medications that are supposed to be helping you. But here with more insight into this is Dr. Scott Kramerick from Riverside Pain Physicians. Thanks so much for being here. And we're going to get into the difference between addicted and dependence, because there is a huge difference between the two. But when people come to see you, are they afraid that they're going to become dependent or addicted to these medications?
A lot of them are, right? They're afraid. They say, I didn't want to come to see you, the pain doctor, because I'm just afraid of being on pain pills and getting addicted to them. I hear that a lot.
Yeah, and that's a common concern, and that might be one reason why some people might not want to get help for their pain, because I'd rather they might think deal with the pain than become addicted or be dependent to these medications.
Right.
But some people really need this medication for legitimate reasons.
So, yes, if you've been in an accident or you're hurt in such a way that you can't move or can't breathe, sometimes that's what we have to do for a little while, is we have to give you some kind of pain medication. And so my take-home message today is I want people to know that if they're with a good, caring physician who's careful and works with them and sees them regularly, they can take these pain medications and then come off of them again when the time is right and not worry about becoming addicted to them.
Well, and can we dive into that, the difference between addicted and dependence?
Right.
And how is it that when somebody, I mean, we've seen those stories of what, it was Rush Limbaugh who was addicted to oxycodone, and that made, you know, news everywhere, and that scared a lot of people,
right,
you know, from taking it. But there's a difference between dependence.
Addicted people just can never get enough medication. No matter how much I give them, they're always asking for more every month. Mm-hmm. They're begging, borrowing, and stealing it from friends. They're running out early. They've got the craziest, funniest stories about where the medication went and,
right,
you know, how they flushed it because it was controlling them. And you want to believe some of these things, but after a point, when you have a pattern of behavior, you start to become more and more concerned as a physician that you've got an addiction developing. Mm-hmm. But dependence is a whole different thing. We all get dependent to these narcotics because of what they do to our body.
Yeah.
So that's a natural reaction.
And what about withdrawal? Does that, what are the symptoms of withdrawal? And do you see people that are concerned about going through withdrawal if they're on some sorts of, like, oxycodone or Percocet or something?
They know. It seems like everybody knows they have to stop taking these medications in a certain way. And they're right. You can't just go cold turkey off of these kinds of narcotic pain medications. You have to do that involving your physician, okay? But withdrawal is anxiety and shaking and chills, cold sweats, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, the really awful stuff. That's withdrawal, the stuff you see on the movies.
Yeah.
Can you withdraw from pain medication if you're not addicted? Yes, because your body gets used to having them, and that's just a physiologic reaction to it. We can't control that. It does not mean that you were addicted. So it's sad sometimes when I see people come back and they need pain medicine. They're like, no, I will never take that again because I took them for a few months and then I just stopped one day and I went through withdrawal, so I was addicted. They come to that conclusion, but it's the wrong conclusion.
Right. You know, and I don't know if it's the same thing to equate it to coffee. Like, if I go through, you know, I have coffee every morning. I know it's completely different from a narcotic, but I have coffee every morning. And then when I don't have my coffee, I get a little bit of a headache, you know, and it's like, I got to have that coffee to help get me through, but I'm trying to wean myself off of, you know, the 4 cups of coffee that I have in the morning. But since you guys know that this is something that can happen, can you guys prevent withdrawals? Can you prevent this from coming on?
It's totally preventable. You don't have to go through withdrawals at all. And the way to do that is to involve your physician in, you know, in your discussions about stopping pain medication. And all we do is just really slow it down. And we have some other medications that we can give you if we have to keep the withdrawals from occurring, to get you down off of it more slowly without any of those nasty side effects and symptoms.
And the bottom line is if somebody is in pain, you know, this is one reason why you have to go seek a professional to get help to manage that pain because of, you know, what the possibilities could be, and have somebody guide you through. Do you see a lot of people coming in with questions about how this is going to affect them if they take a certain kind of medication?
Yeah, people have a lot of questions about their medications because they're afraid of being in this situation, and I have to reassure them that it won't happen if they keep me involved and see me regularly and we talk about these things. But people need medication sometimes for very legitimate reasons, and so we have to be able to preserve our right to give that to them and to make them less afraid of getting what they need so that they can go through physical therapy or come out of surgery or recover from a car accident or whatever it may be. That's sort of the important point here. But the other important point, I think, is there's so many things that we can do to help them with their pain that don't involve narcotics,
okay.
Right? So there's anti-inflammatory medications and nerve pain medications and injections into joints and nerves and muscles and different things that we can do to help them that don't involve pain pills all the time.
So there is a wealth of possibilities. It's just knowing where to start and then having an expert, an anesthesiologist, you know, somebody who can oversee what you're doing to make sure that you can get on to whatever you need to help you get through the pain and then help you safely transition off.
Right. Absolutely. Well put.
Thank you. Appreciate that. Dr. Comerica, appreciate you as always coming on. And we also thank so much Riverside Pain Physicians for sponsoring this segment. And for more information about pain management, the physicians, their locations, you can go to riversidepainphysicians.com or you can call the number there on your screen, which is 904-389-1010.